After World War II, having served his sentence, Albert Speer, a Nazi war criminal and former Minister of Armament and War Production for Nazi Germany, said with certainty that by 1945, Germany could have created several atomic bombs. Though under certain conditions, if all effort had been thrown at the atomic project rather than at producing rockets which Hitler supported, Speer was either wrong or mistaken. Nazi Germany deprived itself of nuclear weapons. Basically, Hitler distrusted new types of weapon. His range of vision was limited to concepts forged by the First World War. However, after successful initial tests, Hitler developed an interest in rockets. In 1943, the young scientist Werner von Braun showed Hitler a color film about rocket flight. Hitler was impressed and awarded the 28-year-old rocket designer the rank of professor. As the war industry leader, Albert Speer believed Hitler's decision to build ballistic rockets at any cost was a mistake. Every day, the Germans built 24 V-2 rockets and sent them towards England. Each one carried a one-ton payload. In the same year, 1944, Allied aircraft rained 35,000 bombs on enemy territory each day. In other words, the most expensive project turned out to be the most senseless. Werner von Braun had no time to complete the development of the Wasserfall surface-to-air missile at Peenemünde, a guided supersonic missile that could have struck any bomber aircraft of the time. Rockets could not save the Third Reich. After World War II, the fruits of the hard work by German rocket designers and developers were used by the Soviet Union and the United States. If Hitler had had an atomic bomb, though, it might have influenced the course of the war. What would have happened to England if London had been shelled not by V-1s and V-2s, but by atomic rockets, and the British capital had been flattened, like Hiroshima in 1945? The former German minister Speer, though, never mentioned the main reason for the failure of Germany's atomic project. The Nazis themselves expelled their best physicists from the country. "There is a primitive kind of anti-Semitism that limits itself to fighting the Jews alone," wrote Johannes Stark, a noted German physicist and Nobel Prize winner. "Its proponents are content to believe that there is a clear dividing line between Jews and non-Jews. They believe the problem would be solved if the Jews were no longer allowed to participate in the political, cultural, and economic life of the nation. But there are also Jews not by blood but by spirit," insisted Stark. He called such bacterial carriers of the Jewish spirit the white Jews, which moved the notion Jew beyond the limits of ethnicity. The Jewish spirit was most visible in physics, and Einstein was its most prominent representative. "All major discoveries and achievements in natural sciences should be attributed to the special gift German researchers had for patient, diligent, and constructive visualization and a personalized dialogue with nature," Stark maintained. A German researcher always sees the so-called theory as an aid. The Jewish spirit brought to the fore the dogmatically declared, divorced from reality theory of relativity. This tirade was published in Das Schwarzkopf, the Black Corps, the criminal SS Empire's in-house publication. A Hitler supporter since the 1920s, Johannes Stark wrote about the National Socialist leader. "The spirit of honesty and inner unity, which we recognized early and advanced in the great scholars of the past, in Galileo, Kepler, Newton, Faraday, we admire and adore it likewise in Hitler and his comrades. We recognize in them our nearest relatives in spirit." Stark picked as his main ally Alfred Rosenberg, the official supervisor of ideological indoctrination, who saw the Nordic spirit in all scientific achievements, and fancied the influence, if not of the Jewish race, then at least of Syrian and Jewish spirit behind the traces of decay. He saw manifestations of Jewish spirit even in the barbarity of the Etruscans, who, supported by the Roman Empire, had ruined Greek civilization, and in the grim role of the Roman Catholic Church, behind which, in his opinion, also stood the Jews. Johannes Stark was an ideological anti-Semite. If a physicist supported the theory of relativity, Stark included him in the list of white Jews. Another Nobel Prize winner, Philipp Lennart, was Johannes Stark's soulmate and close associate. Lennart was awarded the Nobel Prize for Physics in 1905 for his work on cathode rays. In 1907, he was invited to Heidelberg, where he founded the Physics Institute. Lennart named the experimental physics Nordic science and considered theoretical physics a worldwide Jewish fraud. Lennart called Albert Einstein's relativity theory a loathsome creation of Asiatic spirit. It is overwhelmingly important to revise all discoveries in physics made by non-Aryans, wrote Philipp Lennart. To this end, the best thing is to refer to discoveries of their most outstanding representative, the pure-blooded Jew, Albert Einstein. His theory of relativity was to change physics. Actually, the theory has gone bankrupt. Moreover, it could never have been correct. Jewish physics is a distortion of the fundamentals of Aryan physics. In 1936, Johannes Stark wrote in the National Socialist Monthly, "The sensations and publicity of Einstein's theory of relativity were followed by Heisenberg's matrix mechanics and Schrödinger's so-called wave mechanics. The former, just as opaque and formalistic as the latter." Philipp Lennart and Johannes Stark expressed the antipathy of experimental physicists to theoretical physicists, the importance of which had grown in the 1920s after the discovery of the theory of relativity and quantum theory. However, those who had no deep knowledge of modern mathematics did not understand theoretical physics. "Despite a lot of literature," Stark wrote, "theoretical physics has not brought anything new." Both Stark and Lennart were sorely mistaken. Less than 10 years later, relativity and quantum physics made it possible to create the atomic bomb, which changed the world. Immediately after the National Socialists came to power, the science of physics in Germany suffered a heavy blow. Johannes Stark enthusiastically wrote to his friend Lennart that the time had finally come when they could implement their conception of science and research. Stark used the opportunity of a congratulatory letter to his personal acquaintance, National Socialist Minister of the Interior, Wilhelm Frick, to tell him that he and Lennart would be pleased to advise him on the management of scientific institutes in his care. Stark and Lennart gained unprecedented power in science. Now they would decide who could continue to work in German physics. On May 1, 1933, by order of National Socialist Interior Minister Wilhelm Frick, Stark was appointed president of the Reich Physical Technical Institute, which was essentially an opportunity to eradicate Jewish physics. It began with a quarter of all physicists and theoretical physicists, including Albert Einstein, losing their jobs because they were Jewish or rejected National Socialism. In addition, CA Obergruppenführer Bernhard Rust, the new Imperial Minister of Science, Education and National Culture, appointed Stark head of the German Research Foundation. Johannes Stark attacked the Nobel Prize winner, Werner Heisenberg, the only man who could have created nuclear weapons for Adolf Hitler. Stark wrote another article for the SS Black Corps magazine, which said, "In 1933, Heisenberg, together with Einstein's students, Schrödinger and Dirac, was awarded the Nobel Prize. That was a demonstration of the Nobel Prize Committee influenced by Jews against National Socialist Germany. Heisenberg is one of the vicars of Jewry and German spirit, who should disappear like Jews themselves." Werner Heisenberg was always a very proud man. When the future Nobel Prize laureate was six, his teacher hit him with a ruler for a childish transgression. Later, the teacher apologized, but young Heisenberg would not accept the apology and never again looked the teacher in the face. Heisenberg wrote a personal letter to SS Reichsführer Heinrich Himmler, refuting all accusations and asking for Himmler's protection. He had a good reason to believe that Himmler would heed his request, as Himmler's father and Heisenberg's maternal grandfather had been teachers at the same school. However, an answer only came after a year, in July 1938, when a despairing Heisenberg was already preparing to leave Germany. "As your letter came on the recommendation of my family," Himmler wrote, "I ordered a very careful and rigorous investigation into your case. I disapprove of the Black Corps attacks against you and will oppose their recurrence." Why did Himmler intervene on behalf of the white Jew Heisenberg and oppose the faithful National Socialist Johannes Stark? First, Himmler didn't pass up the opportunity to give a rough time to Stark and Leonard's patron, Reichsleiter Alfred Rosenberg, who considered himself the chief Nazi Party ideologue, and on several occasions had rather rudely intimated that Himmler should not intrude into the ideological sphere, which he considered his exclusive domain. Second, Stark had many enemies, as other scientists and statesmen in Nazi Germany disliked his ambition. Stark was accused of having wasted considerable sums of Research Foundation money to finance a worthless project to refine gold from peat. In 1936, Stark was forced to resign from the German Research Foundation and soon lost his post at the Institute. After World War II, the denazification court in Traunstein convicted and sentenced him as a major offender to 4 years of hard labor. And finally, another reason that Himmler supported the young physicist Werner Heisenberg was that Himmler decided to use him. Himmler had peculiar scientific views and interests. He believed in the transmigration of souls and considered himself the reincarnation of German Emperor Heinrich I. Himmler established Annenebi, Ancestral Heritage, a think tank that operated in Nazi Germany between 1935 and 1945 and was an appendage of the Schutzstaffel, the SS. Originally, it was devoted to Germanic studies, but during the war, the humanities were pushed to the background. Research of targeted defense importance was prioritized, including experiments conducted on people in concentration camps. Himmler told SS Obergruppenführer Reinhard Heydrich, chief of the Reich Main Security Office, "We may need Heisenberg for ancestral heritage, if it one day becomes a true academy of sciences." Meanwhile, the future of Germany's atomic project was being decided. Himmler's sudden support saved Heisenberg from police repression, but nationally-minded Germans still saw him as a white Jew. He sought a professorship at the University of Munich, but was refused, as the Reich Ministry of Education had promised the post to an Aryan physicist. However, after the start of World War II, advocates of Aryan physics began to lose their leading positions. The Wehrmacht and Ministry of Weapons were not concerned with ideology. The army developed an interest in the prospective creation of nuclear weapons, and the Leonard Stark group was useless in that area. In 1939, Heisenberg was called up for military service. However, he was not sent to the mountain unit to which he had been assigned, but to the Wehrmacht Weapons Command. Working with other physicists, he investigated the possibility of the practical use of nuclear energy. In 1942, Heisenberg was invited by the Kaiser Wilhelm Institute for Physics in Berlin to develop a nuclear reactor. The idea of atomic weapons captured the attention of Colonel General Friedrich Fromm, the Army Equipment Chief. The new superweapon would have given Germany a chance to win the war. Colonel General Fromm discussed it with the armaments minister, Albert Speer. In May 1942, Speer, Fromm, and several other generals met with physicists, Werner Heisenberg and Otto Hahn among them, who would be awarded the Nobel Prize in autumn 1945. Minister Speer asked Heisenberg if it was possible to create an atomic bomb. Heisenberg said the scientific solution had been found, but that they lacked the technical facilities, and complained that he was short of funds and materials. He added that because laboratory assistants and technicians were being drafted into the army, German science was losing its leading position. Colonel General Fromm promised to return several hundred researchers from the army. Minister Speer allocated the nuclear physicists 2 million marks and rare metals from the Reich Reserve Fund and added the construction of the first German cyclotron to the list of priority matters of national importance. Later, in June 1942, Speer discreetly reported to Hitler about progress in the atomic bomb development project. Hitler wanted to know what controlled chain reaction meant, but failed to understand the basics of nuclear physics, even in layman's terms. Scientists who he believed to be reputable further influenced his attitude. They insisted that nuclear physics was a Jewish fraud. German intelligence services had not even the slightest idea about the Manhattan Project, large-scale research to develop nuclear weapons in the United States. Neither Abwehr, German intelligence and counterintelligence, headed by Admiral Wilhelm Canaris, nor political intelligence, headed by SS Brigadeführer Walter Schellenberg, ever came to hear of it. Meanwhile, in Berlin, Minister Speer for the last time spoke to nuclear physicists asking just one question: when? Upon hearing that it would take at least 3 to 4 years to develop a nuclear weapon, he ordered the discontinuation of all works. Speer reasoned that in 4 years, either the war would have come to an end or its outcome would be clear, with or without the bomb. In the summer of 1943, neutral Portugal stopped selling tungsten to Germany, imperiling arms production. And Minister Speer ordered uranium ore to be used. 1,200 tons of uranium were sent to armament factories. The idea of developing atomic weapons was shot down. Some historians believe that if Speer had known about the Manhattan Project, he would have given his right arm to catch up with the Americans. However, Nazi Germany was not as rich as America. From 1939, Germany had been at war continuously, and all resources went to satisfy the army's vital needs. America spent $2 billion developing the atomic bomb. Nazi Germany, 8 million marks, or 1/1000th of American appropriations at the exchange rate of the time. Unlike the US, which had never been bombed, Germany could not have built a large-scale production facility, as it would have been detected by air reconnaissance and destroyed. Karl Friedrich von Weizsäcker, a leading German physicist, will say much later, "None of us in Germany ever had the idea that during the war, any country could spend such an enormous amount of money on an enterprise whose success was not certain. And when we learned about the Hiroshima bomb, we were absolutely surprised." Heisenberg's position is unclear. Some historians believe that he deliberately prevented the implementation of Germany's atomic project, as he did not want to develop a bomb for Hitler. After the war, Heisenberg himself asserted that he was happy when Hitler and Speer dropped the idea. German scientists, led by Werner Heisenberg, had been working in the same direction as Americans until around the end of 1941. At that time, the Americans decided to build the bomb, while German physicists opted for continued development of a reactor. When the first bomb was dropped on Hiroshima in 1945, he did not believe it. He could not imagine that the Americans had done it. The last reactor model built by Heisenberg in February 1945 could allegedly have generated energy if all the uranium and heavy water available in Germany had been used. If that had been the case, the Germans would have reached the level Americans had surpassed in 1942. Unaware of that, the Office of Strategic Services, a US wartime intelligence agency, planned an attempt on Heisenberg's life to kick him out of the game. In December 1944, a small group of professors and postgraduate students met in Zurich for a lecture on matrix theory, given by Werner Heisenberg. Among his Swiss audience was a man who had brought a gun and a cyanide ampoule to the lecture. Posing as a Swiss student, Maurice Berg was really an American agent with the Office of Strategic Services, dispatched to analyze Heisenberg's lecture and assess his knowledge of atomic weapons. If Berg concluded that Heisenberg was close to a bomb, he had orders to shoot the German physicist and to swallow the ampoule if arrested by the Swiss police. A graduate of Princeton University, the Sorbonne and Columbia Law School, Maurice Berg could hold a conversation on any topic, and he spoke several languages. When the war began, he was employed to work for intelligence and assigned to the German atomic project. He hopped around Europe, interviewing physicists and finding out what they knew about atomic bomb development in Germany. After hearing Heisenberg's lecture, Berg did not even reach for his gun. Yet the United States feared that Nazi Germany could possess nuclear weapons. The idea was strongly supported by Albert Einstein and other physicists driven from the country. They pressed the American president, Franklin Roosevelt, and British Prime Minister, Winston Churchill, because they still considered German physics to be the most advanced. they did not realize that German physics had left Germany with them.